Random House Audio presents Wickett's Remedy by Myla Goldberg. Read for you by me, the author. With David Aaron Baker, Chris Burns, Ilyana Kadushin, and Stina Nielsen. On D Street, there was no need for alarm clocks. The drays, ever punctual, were an army storming the gates of sleep. The wooden wagons were heavy and low-riding with loud, rattling wheels, their broad planks too battered and begrimed to recall distant origins as trees. Each dray was pulled by horses, two, four, or sometimes six per wagon, pounding down nearby 3rd Street. Windows rattled and floors shook. The sound was a giant hand shaking Lydia Kilkenny's sleeping shoulders.
When her daughter was still a wee thing, Cora Kilkenny recalls Lydia crediting the sound to God waking up all the good Catholics of D Street.
Each morning, she did not awaken to the sound, but inside it. In winter, the drays came when the sky was still dark, their pounding hooves sharp reports against the frozen cobblestones. In summer, perhaps because the sky was already pale with light, the sound of the horses seemed kinder. She knew the clattering wagons were bound for Boston proper, but the vague tangle of streets across the Broadway bridge surfaced in her mind with the sound of the horses and resubmerged with its diminishment. As the flow of drays subsided, the wagons no longer traveling two by two but single file, pounding hooves gave way to the creak of floorboards and the muffled voices of neighbors. Factory whistles blew. Church bells rang. The vegetable man made his way down D Street shouting, "Fresh tomatoes," even if there were no tomatoes, because those words distinguished him from the other vegetable men who plied their carts through Southie. As Lydia stirred, her mother put up water for cocoa and oatmeal.
Jamie remembers the warm press of his sister's hands as she lifted him from bed and set him down beside the clothes she had waiting for him, the sound of the horses rattling inside his head like loose marbles.
By the time Lydia had the little ones dressed, Michael and their father had finished their morning ablutions and the wash basin was hers alone. By the time she had brushed and pinned her hair, the drays were gone. Indeterminate Boston had once again been vanquished by the certainty of Southie. South Boston belonged to Lydia as profoundly and wordlessly as her thimble finger. Her knowledge of its streets was more complete than any atlas, her mental maps reflecting changes that occurred from season to season, day to day, and hour to hour. Each time she left 28 D Street, one among a row of identical triple-decker tenements lining the street like so many stained teeth, her route reflected this internal almanac. If on a Tuesday afternoon her mother wanted flour and jam from Hennessy's, Lydia would avoid the more direct route along 5th Street due to her dislike of the soap grease man and his fleshy block of laundry soap. No matter what the errand, 3rd Street was best avoided in the early evening when the flood tide of drays returning to their stables posed a threat to both body and nose. In deep winter, when ice and hard-packed snow made walking treacherous, West Broadway was the place to catch a ride on the tailboard of a snow dray, delivering milk, groceries, or beer, but sledding was best saved for Dorchester Heights. If a good enough sled could be found, and if the streets were not too crowded, it was possible to start at G Street and traverse almost a quarter of the alphabet, all the way to L Street. Whether because he was luckier or a year older, Michael was the superior sledder. At her best, Lydia could only make J Street before her sled or her resolve gave out. Because Dan Kilkenny was an iceman, the whole D Street gang was in thrall to Lydia and Michael in summer. In the thick of that season, there were few things more magical than ice. The blocks that emerged impossibly from the back of the wagon, steaming not with heat but with cold. The unmistakable stomp of the Iceman conquering the stairwell, gleaming blocks of ice piled on his broad back like enormous melting diamonds. Contrary to Father O'Brien's Sunday descriptions of a place streaming with light and angel song, Lydia was certain heaven resembled the interior of her father's ice wagon, a dark place, cool and quiet. There, the salt hay, sawdust, and straw effaced the airborne tang of leather and glue from the nearby shoe factory and muted the call of the ragman. On very hot days, there was no need to confer in advance. The lot of them would be playing ball in Commonwealth Park or ambling toward the beach at City Point or playing marbles or kick the wicket on the street. Without a word, Michael would turn to Lydia, or she toward him, and with a whoop, they would preempt the day's pursuit and set out for ice.
Had Margaret Kelly, of 32 D Street, claimed an Iceman for her da, she would not have been so lordly about it. Lydia and Mick always waited until the worst of the heat, and then made them line up for Indian knuckle burns before bringing them down the right street.
At the sight of Dan Kilkenny's brood, the Iceman would toss out an extra block, the surplus ice arcing toward the street in a dream of captured light before exploding into frozen bliss on the cobbles. Decorum was traded for the fleeting comfort of ice pressed into the perfect place. Frozen shatterings found their way into mouths, inside shirts and dresses, under chins, and atop closed eyes. Ice was nestled into the hollows of throats and hammocked by the webbing between fingers and toes. Ice bent the iron rule of summer for a few precious moments before the heat clamped down again. For 10 years, this was enough. Then, in fifth grade, Lydia saw a city map and realized her entire world was the smallest finger of Boston's broad hand. The hazy destination of the morning drays acquired focus. Across the bridge lay Boston Common and the swan boats of the public garden. Across the bridge lay Washington Street, the longest street in all New England, which began like any other, but then continued south, a single determined thread of cobblestone that wove itself through every town from Boston to Providence. Once Lydia saw Washington Street, she knew she could not allow it to exist without her. She had imagined Washington wide like West Broadway, but instead it was narrower, its buildings taller. On Washington, men in blazers and boaters strutted three and four abreast, and bustled women drifted cloud-like between shop windows. The air on Washington smelled neither of factories nor piers, but of occasional cigar smoke and wafting perfume. The buildings, with their marble facades and grand entranceways and their seemingly endless layers of arched windows, resembled fancy wedding cakes. On Washington Street, there was not a clothesline in sight, not a single vegetable or fish man. Striped awnings stretched proudly above showcase displays of objects Southie had never seen, a silk opera gown with black glass buttons, a set of tortoiseshell combs, a rocking horse with a mane of real hair.
Mick recalls only his disappointment. Before Liddy went gaga over Washington Street, they had always pooled their copper for penny fudge.
Lydia turned toward Michael, whose trolley fare she had provided from a cache of saved pennies, their passage across the Broadway Bridge, her 11th birthday present to herself, and announced that this was her future. On graduating 8th grade, when her girlfriends found jobs behind sewing machines, Lydia rode to Washington Street alone and procured a position in the stockroom of Gilchrist's department store. Now every morning she had to wake before the drays in order to make the streetcar. During dreary hours of inventory and reshelving, her resolve to work on the far side of the bridge would falter, but her doubts vanished whenever she was called onto the gleaming sales floor. Walking among the wonders of the display rooms, she would calculate the weeks of salary required to purchase a beaded French chapeau, or the impossible amount of roast ham that could be eaten in lieu of one opal earring. Rather than discouraging her, these extreme calculations bred optimism. Once she was promoted to sales, she hoped eventually to save enough so that she too could point to one of those fantastical objects and have it delivered into her outstretched hand. Michael joked that his sister rode the streetcar every day to make up for never having outdistanced him on a sled. Though he was as immune as the rest of the family to the forces that drew her to Washington Street, he formulated a theory to explain the aberration. I don't know how it came to be, he informed her, once it became clear she would not be abandoning her streetcar commute. But it looks like you turned out the migrating bird in a family of pigeons. Lydia treasured his gift, picturing herself as she rode the streetcar, as one of the long-necked geese whose silhouettes she observed angling south in late autumn. On the other side of the bridge, Lydia learned the difference between a heavy tub silk and a crepe de chine shirt and the relative merits of a Norfolk versus a sack suit. She learned that the best suit jackets were nipped in at the waist and slope-shouldered. When a counter girl was fired for tardiness, Lydia was ready. She claimed the sales floor for herself. For 4 years, she worked behind a lustrous wood counter on the store's ground level, amid polished marble floors and hanging crystal lamps. Gilchrist's Tiffany Rotunda gazed down.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.